Hello, everyone. My name is Ann Pullmanberg from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. And I was asked by the meeting organizers to reprise a talk I gave at the Positive Strand RNA Virology meeting earlier this year. And that talk basically reprised a paper that a colleague of mine, Rob Kaleda, also at Wisconsin, and I wrote in 2017, comparing gender preferences or gender selections for speakers at four prominent virology meetings over the last 35 years. And we were prompted to do this because both Rob and I are conference organizers. I work strongly with the ASV, and he's involved with the International Herpes Virus Workshop. And as conference organizers, one wants to know how to make the best possible speaker programs, and at the same time, with attention to parity for gender and also the topics, having the best possible science at the presentations. And finding a balance among those things is sometimes hard to get the right slate of speakers. We both were very aware that in the meetings that we attend over the past 35 years, both of us are rather senior, that there was probably a pretty strong predominance of male speakers rather than female speakers. And we wanted to make sure that didn't happen at the meetings we were organizing. So as the way to get around that and the way to find out what had happened previously so that we could figure out what to do at our respective meetings, we took the program books from four prominent virology meetings that we attend frequently. And those were the American Society for Virology, the International Herpes Workshop, which are the two meetings we're intimately involved with, and also Positive Strand RNA Viruses and the Gordon Research Conferences on Cells and Viruses. These are representative of other virology conferences, although we make no claims about what happens at other virology conferences. But these are meetings that we attend quite frequently, and we wanted to see what had happened historically in these meetings, and also, therefore, what we could do to make sure that we had gender parity going into the future. Now, that original paper we put out in 2017, I'm just going to reprise small amounts of that for you here. The point of today's talk really is an update from that 2017 data with what's happened since then as a consequence of publishing our paper. So that original paper summarized information from more than 2,000 invited talks, which are the most important talks of the meeting, either keynote or symposia. And obviously there is overlap among these different meetings with people who speak, and also sometimes people are invited back for repeat talks or talks in the same series that they give 3, 4, 5, 10 years apart. So our data basically encompass a little over 1,000 individuals for 2,387 different invited talks. The dendrogram you are looking at in the middle of the screen basically shows how people in these different conferences overlap. So for example, there are some people who have given talks in both ASV and in the herpes, but not in the GRC or from any combination of two. And of the 1,000 people we worked with in our survey, only 5 of them had actually given talks in all four different conferences. So you can see that there are very different demographics and different interests of these groups. And we were interested to see what was going on in these units with respect to gender. In total, we basically transcribed the names of all the people from the program books into spreadsheets, along with things like who were chairing the sessions, who did the short talks, state of the arts, whether they were named lectureships, and the names of the organizers that were there. And all of those data are summarized in the original paper. So this was actually a very large and comprehensive data set looking for how men and women are differentially invited to speak at these major conferences so that we could see if there was a pattern, and if so, what was causing that pattern. So this is the 2017 numbers that were published in that original paper. And the data take this kind of format. It's actually quite simple. We made graphs that charted the green graph along the top, simply charts the number of speakers who were invited in any particular year. This is the data for the American Society for Virology conference, which started in 82. And of the number of speakers, we plot how many were male and how many were female. And we were able to assign gender either because we know most of the people in the field, or we could go up on websites and we could look up people that we didn't know or who were historical and we had never met to find out their gender. So for every individual in our study, we were able to unambiguously assign gender. And what's plotted in the blue and the red dots are the percentage for any given year of male and female speakers. The lines are linear regressions that simply show the trend over those 35 years of ASV for what was happening with males and females. Obviously, as fewer males are added to the program, more females are, or vice versa. The lines obviously are reciprocal because the percentage has to add up to the 100% of speakers. So this is the kind of data that we collected and is actually publicly available. Calculated from the names of every speaker over 35 years. In addition, since we have the names of these people and whether or not they spoke previously at a previous ASV, for example, they might have given a talk in 85 and then another one in 90, we were able to track by year how many of these speakers, in fact, had given previous talks and how many of them were new to the series. So there are equivalent graphs in the original paper that show the percentage of males and the percentage of females who were new to the series in any given year. To not put too many dots on this graph, we plot those data. This is the update, by the way, for 2019. I'll talk more about that in a moment, but we are able to take for any of these years and plot how many of the speakers that we recorded in a given year had already given a talk in a previous year. So the difference between the dotted line and the solid line, for example, the blue dotted line and the blue solid line, the difference there, which is about 25% for men in ASV, is the number of speakers in a given year who would have been invited previously. In other words, they were prominent scientists who had been invited at least once, if not more than once, in a previous year. So the dotted line really is the number of new people in a year. And the difference between that and the solid line is how many total speakers there were. So basically, the American Society for Virology, over 35 years, recycles on average about 25% of their speakers as men who have given previous ASV talks. The number of female speakers is lower across the board for all years, and the number of females who are asked to give repeat talks, that's the difference between the red line and the red dotted line, is obviously lower. So there are fewer women, and they are asked to repeat fewer times than is clear with the men. And I pointed out a minute ago that this new graph here has the data through 2019. The original paper was 2017. This year, all four conferences met, so we've updated all of the spreadsheets. And I want to show you the data for what's happened since we put out the original and what's happened now. So this is the trend in ASV over the past 37 years now for male and female speakers. And it also shows the demographics of how frequently speakers are recycled or asked for repeat talks in subsequent years. We have similar data. There's the ASV data. We have similar data for the positive strand RNA virology conference. This is a meeting that's held only every 3 years. So obviously there were fewer dots. And one difference in these data versus ASV is that the dotted line is lower, has a lower slope than the solid line for men, which means that the plus strand RNA meeting on average uses more male speakers who have spoken previously. In other words, they're recycling senior people who have been on the program previously. And again, as with women, there are many fewer women who are used in this program throughout the course of 30 years. And of them, very few of the women are asked to give repeated talks. The same is true for the herpes virus and the Gordon Cells and Virus conferences. The herpes workshop meets every year. The Gordon meets every other year. And I think you can see from the dotted lines versus the solid lines that particularly in the herpes workshop, almost 40% of the speakers in any given year are men who have been previously asked to speak. Very few of the women, there are many fewer women, you can see from the red line, but also many fewer of those women are asked to give repeated talks. So it's clear from these data, and it's clear from what we published previously, that all of these conferences going back 30 years have a history basically of bias against women selection for speakers. Now, that's a historical trend, and it simply is what the data say. It makes no conclusion about why that is so, simply that this is, in fact, the history. On the other hand, the slopes all go down. So that means that over recent years, and we'll talk more about that later, especially over the last decade, the percentage of women has been increasing in all of these programs. And that's because, as you'll see, because of transparency. So let's talk first about the use of new people and how that affects the trends in gender. So obviously, if the pool of people who have given talks before is primarily male, it's to be expected that if you draw new speakers or speakers for a future meeting from that pool, they will also be predominantly male. So we wanted to find out if, in fact, that was true across the board, and just how much of an impact adding new people to a program made on the selection of gender. So this is data updated from what we had in the paper. On the top graph, we selected the last 20 years of ASV, because by that time, the programs had pretty much stabilized. There were no in the first year of a meeting, obviously, everybody is a new speaker. But as time goes on, you have the choice of an organizer of picking old speakers, people who have been on the podium previously, or new speakers. So for the last 20 years of ASV, the top left graph shows 20 dots, and 10 of them are open and 10 of them are closed. And the open ones basically are those 10 meetings who had the fewest first-time speakers. The closed dots are those that had the most first-time speakers, and the dots are plotted as a percent of the men at that particular meeting. In other words, how does adding first-time speakers change the way in which men are added to the program? So the average of the closed dots and the open dots are in the graph on the top right, and it shows that clearly the more recycled or previous males one had on a program, the fewer women there would be. Conversely, the more new people were added to a program in a given year, the more likely those people were to be women. And there's an obvious reason for that, and that's the bottom graph, which is if you simply tabulate totally men and women added to those speaker programs over the years, men are added to the speaker programs historically over the last 35 years at three times the rate of women. And that means that if you pick a speaker for another program from the previous pool, it's three times more likely that that speaker will be male than female. Therefore, if you want to get more women onto the program, don't put men who have spoken previously. You have to add new speakers. New speakers are going to be selected from a new pool. And by definition, that new pool is not the historical pool. And if not the historical pool, there's a much greater chance that new speakers will be women. And in fact, that's borne out. You can see the graphs on here are updated through 2014. And there is a trend away from, for both the blue and the red lines, away from the regression curve, which is the dotted line. And what that means is that in recent years, men have not been added to programs at three times the rate of women. But historically, the pool is still three times greater. In fact, since 2015, just looking at the last couple of years of how these four meetings have used new women in their programs, new men have been added to the programs 21 to 19 relative to new women, which essentially is parity. Most of these meetings have demographics made up between 45 to 48% female. So in recent years, by adding new speakers, one adds more women to the programs simply because they are new speakers. So dipping into the historic pools means you will pull out men who have previously given talks. Dipping into new pools means you will get women who have not previously given talks. So how programs are balanced between previous speakers and new speakers makes a huge difference on whether or not there is parity for women. Now, the question comes, what should we be aiming at? What is the right ratio that one these meetings should be aiming for? Should we be looking at equality? Should we be looking at plurality? Should we have quotas? That's a terrible word. Should we be looking for equity when organizers design programs? So to give you an idea of what those words really mean in terms of speaker selection, I took these images off of the web from Helena Powerhouse because I think they very well, and she's written extensively on equity in science for women. But I like these images because they tell us pretty clearly, where do we want to be? So one could define equality as everybody gets the same shot, regardless of whether or not there's previous historical difficulties or whether some people or some speakers or some PIs require more help than others in order to be able to see over the fence and participate in the game. Equity basically says we recognize that there are underrepresented groups, and we recognize that there are groups that have been previously have had bias, and we should go out of our way to try to give these people visibility on a program so that their programs become equivalent to others. And to do that, basically, it's another word, I would say equity is another word for affirmative action. One sometimes has to stack the boxes a little bit differently in order to make sure everybody can see over the fence. In other words, you have to reach out of your comfort zone, reach out of your own colleagues in order to provide equity for other PIs that perhaps you wouldn't normally think of as being putting on the podium in a major meeting. But the problem with not doing that, with not providing affirmative action, is the historic context. And the data say, as you could see from those graphs, that there were some people who historically benefited from being invited over and over and over and over and over, regardless of the science, and others who were never invited, regardless of the science. So the reality of the situation is, in the absence of affirmative action, that the historical mores really do show a significant bias toward women on the podium. So what are you going to do about it? If you want to have equity, the boxes have to be differently distributed, and there has to be a conscious effort to provide equity to everybody in the entire demographic instead of simply pulling speakers out of the previous historic context. So who stacks the boxes? Well, that's the question, isn't it? Who gets to say who's on the podium and who's not? We would like to think that we pick speakers because it's always the best science. But if that were true, then there would be equity across the board historically for all of these meetings. So who stacks the boxes? You do, and particularly meeting organizers. And that comes out when you simply look at these meetings and figure out who was in charge when there were different percentages of males and females on the program. So these are data from the 1917 paper, and it simply plots for ASV, IHW, and GRC if there was a female president who got to select the speakers versus a male president, there was a 20% difference in whether or not there were males or females on the program that year. So it's not that the females picked worse science, it's that the females picked more females, or the men pick more men. So the bias is innate to the organizers, not to the science that was put on the program. International Herpes, excuse me, works by a somewhat different format. There is a small local organizing committee who selects the speakers. So with ASV, it's primarily the president who then ratifies the slate through the council. with IHV if that small council had even a single female member on it. It made a 10% difference in the number of women who are on the program. And the same is true for Gordon Research Conference. A female chair versus a male chair made an almost 20% difference in who was on the program that year. So good science is inherent to any of these programs, but the bias or the selection procedures between old speakers, new speakers, young speakers, older speakers who have previously been participated in programs, and male and female, basically lie with the organizers, and they can influence this to a very, very great extent. You have to be conscious that they are doing that. They have to be conscious they're doing that, and that will change what happens in the programs. Okay, so if equity is what we aim at, let's just call it what it is, which is affirmative action. You have to look far and try very hard as an organizer to make sure that you are bringing in representatives of all the different fields and all the genders that are involved to represent your demographics. And until we basically don't have to do that anymore, because there is equality or there is equity in our profession, we're sort of stuck with still waiting for organizers to stack the boxes appropriately. Now, given that, what's been happening in the last couple of years, because we've been beating this drum of equity and equality and, for the last 35 years. So here again is the graph for American Society for Virology through 2019, and it's plotted with a regression, with a linear regression to show the trend. But I think it's pretty clear, just looking at the last decade, that the red dots and the blue dots really, over that period of time, don't really fit the line anymore. And what that means is that over the recent past, there's been a shakeup in the system. And in fact, a linear regression really isn't the way to represent these data anymore. So here are the same data plotted, but this time with a polynomial regression that basically shows the previous slope for, say, the first 20, 25 years of ASV is pretty constant. There was a dominance of men over women, selected speakers, but the slopes changed pretty dramatically over the last decade. And in fact, actually in 2017, the lines cross and have remained crossed. In other words, haven't reverted back to, more men than women. And I would say that these data now indicate that probably since about 2017, ASV has achieved a sustainable level of parity between male and female speakers on their program. And that's reflected by just simply using a different curve to represent the data. In other words, the historical trends are no longer true for ASV. The recent trends are that there's essentially parity between men and women in ASV. Now, coincidence or not, in 2008, the year I became president of ASV, when I had to put together my program for the following meeting, I made the first spreadsheets that listed names, so simply so I could go through and make sure I was not overlooking different topics, I was not overlooking different people, and I wanted also to have a record of who had spoken previously to make sure that I didn't unnecessarily duplicate the programs. So in 2008, the first speaker spreadsheets became available for ASV, listing at that time probably 15 years worth of ASV speaker data. The data obviously we have today is for all 35 years and all speakers, but the first preliminary spreadsheets came out in 2008. And since that time, I think you can see that transparency, by simply looking at the spreadsheets and what had happened previously, changed the slope of the curve. And actually, this is true for every single one of the meetings that we follow. There's the ASV data again through 2019. This is the plus strand meeting, this time plotted with a polynomial regression. And I think you can see also for this meeting that the slope recently over the last decade is considerably different than it was in the previous 20 years of the meeting. That's true also for herpes, which has an extraordinarily positive downward slope in the number of men and upward slope in the number of women over the past decade. So in other words, the slopes have changed, and the slopes have changed in the last 10 years relative to the historical context of these meetings. And the same is true for the Gordon Research Conference. In every case here, this is when the spreadsheets became available that simply tabulated the data for what had happened with the historical precedents. In other words, since spreadsheets became available that simply informed organizers of what was happening in their programs, who had spoken before, when did they speak, what was the last time a given speaker had given a presentation, what was the percentage of new speakers versus previous speakers, with that information, the organizers were able to make better informed choices, which translated directly into an increase in women in all four of these programs. And this actually is a trend that we should, as a profession, be very, very proud of. Even the units that historically had very bad representation of women have changed the mores, have changed what they do. And what they are doing now is much, much more informed than what had happened previously. And in fact, these trends are now so positive that we have to reevaluate what we wrote in that 1917 paper. In the 17 paper, we predicted by where the linear regression lines would cross that none of these meetings would reach parity for males and females until a minimum of a decade away. And in fact, for herpes, where there was historically a much larger gap, we predicted it might take as long as 3 decades before, at the current rate of adding women to the program, they would reach equity. But if you change the slopes according to what's happened strictly within the last decade, forget the past, let's go into the future, then we could positively say that both ASV and GRC have, in their current way of selecting speakers, probably reached a sustainable level of parity for males and females on their speaker rosters. And that's because of the transparency that's brought forth by spreadsheets and by making organizers aware of the parameters that change that kind of parity. IHW and the Plus Strand only meets every 3 years. It takes them a little longer to accumulate new data. And herpes is certainly working very, very strongly to include more women in their programs. They're aware of what they're doing. They're aware that new people make a difference. And the programs, I think, over the last decade or so, particularly within the last 5 years, have made a remarkable change in the way speakers are selected and therefore in representation of women on the program. Okay, so what about those data? So that's really positive news that these are happening. I want to make you all aware that these spreadsheets exist and they are public. They're on my website, but this is the kind of information that's encapsulated in there. We have the names of the speakers and what meeting they spoke at, the year they spoke, and pretty much where they're from, the topic that they spoke on. All of this is public information because this is derived strictly from program books. We do not make available things like email addresses for speakers. If you want those and want to look somebody up, you have to do that on your own. But the data that are in here are available on my website because they promote awareness. And each of the spreadsheets for the four different meetings listing all of the speakers and this kind of information is available on my website. The spreadsheets were just updated this year because all four of those meetings met this year. So the new data are out there, and Rob and I will try to keep them updated as the new iterations of the meetings come out. These are wonderful sources for looking up speakers. If you are organizing a meeting and you want a herpes virologist, go to the herpes sheets and look them up. It will tell you who the new people are, who the repeat speakers are, the topics that they have spoken about, the years they spoke, you can cross-check between them and get new ideas for new speakers and I had forgotten about that person. Let's go look that one up. I'd forgotten they gave such a wonderful talk 5 years ago. Let's look them up and see if we can use them again. So again, we make these data publicly available for organizers or anyone who wants to look them up. All of the information in here is public. We've simply consolidated it into one spot. So just to bring this more or less to a close here, awareness, which is basically transparency, means that that organizers of meetings basically have to cast wide nets. You simply can't go into the historical pot and pull out names and expect to have a balanced program. You have to cast a net looking for new names, looking for new people. Stir the pot. Try to go outside of your comfort zone, outside of your own colleagues, looking for new people. And this is especially important for youngsters who would like to break into the system and get themselves on a podium for the first major talk in their careers. If you have a major paper, which is fantastic, and you want meeting organizers to know about it, send them an email, show them your new paper so that they have in mind who the new people are, and you remind them, hey, I'm new to this field, I'd like to break into it. If my work is of sufficient quality, remember me the next time you're putting a meeting together. So this is a community effort, not just an organizer effort, in order to make sure that we have the right names of youngsters to put on the podium, and that we look further than just our own colleagues to put people on the podium. And in doing so, this increases parity in an enormous way for women. And the data that we've collected, and certainly the new trends, suggest that this technique works well. Okay, so awareness. Back in the 1980s, when these data started, basically women had to sit and wait until a guy opened the door for them and maybe thought of them, maybe didn't think of them, to put on the podium for a major meeting. And the result of that was that if you sat silently and waited for a male to select you, you'd wait an awful long time. Many senior women in the field today did not give a major talk until maybe 30 years into their careers, because we sat and waited. I say it personally for myself, sat and waited for men to invite us. That doesn't happen anymore. What you have to do is get your name out there, have transparency in the system, make the organizers aware of what the previous trends were and what the aims should be. And as a result, this is where we'd really like to be, with women more in the driver's seat than as a passenger waiting to be invited. So I'm going to end this here with a thank you to you for listening, for me to stand on this soapbox. Also, thank you to Rob, who's a very important personal colleague and was actually the instigator for writing the original paper. So the two of us together are in this. Now, I understand that at the end of this webinar, we don't have an opportunity for questions, but I will tell you the questions that are asked of me frequently when I give this kind of talk. One of them is, why haven't we tabulated minority data, and why haven't we tabulated gender preference data for the LGBT community, for example? And the answer for that is that we simply do not have access to such data. That's one reason. There is no way race and gender preferences are self-described. There's no way you basically need someone to say, hey, this is how I identify myself. And we don't collect that kind of information at a meeting. Moreover, even if we did collect such information at a meeting, say through the registration process, I would consider that information absolutely private and would never put it on a public website. Gender, as in male, female, is something that we can readily identify and put in the spreadsheets and is not private. So we don't tabulate other information, not because it's not important in selection criteria, but because, in fact, we have no way to collect that, and certainly would not invade somebody's privacy to try to collect it. So we've stuck to gender parity for male and female in our tabulations. Maybe moving forward, some of you youngsters, when you come up through the system, can take the information we gathered and expand on that. So don't ask me, don't send me a question and say, hey, how come you don't have minority data? And the reason for that is that we simply have no way to collect it. But other than that, if you have questions about the kind of data we have collected and what it means and what we think the impact has been on the profession, please send me an email and I'll be glad to see if I can answer your questions. Again, thank you very much for your attention.